Hello everyone, I am K. Devavani, Assistant Professor of Microbiology, working in Government Degree College for Women, Nalgunda. In this video, I am going to present a topic on acquired immunity. This is a topic in continuation of the innate immunity and the immunity that was explained earlier. As explained earlier, immunity is the resistance offered by the host in response to the infections. Immunity is categorized into two types, innate immunity and adaptive immunity. Innate immunity is also called as a non-specific immunity or inborn immunity that was explained in the previous video about the factors and the mechanisms of innate immunity. Now I am going to present on acquired, this is also called as adaptive or also called as a specific immunity. Acquired immunity means it is the resistance that an individual develops during his lifetime. It's not inborn, it is acquired in his lifetime by means of exposure to either to the antigens or receiving the antibodies. It is called as a acquired or adaptive immunity. This acquired immunity is again different kinds. It is either natural or artificial. Again, natural can be classified into active immunity and passive immunity. Artificial again can be classified into active immunity and passive immunity. Natural active immunity means it is by means of exposing to the infectious agents. Natural passive immunity means it is receiving the antibodies from mother to child. Artificial active immunity means taking the vaccines by means of the immunization process. Artificial passive immunity means receiving the already ready-made antibodies, already prepared. This acquired or adaptive immunity has four characteristic features. They are antigenic specificity, diversity, immunological memory, self and non-self recognition. The acquired or adaptive immunity has four important features. They are antigenic specificity, diversity, immunological memory, and self and non-self recognition. Antigenic specificity means the immune system is able to identify different antigens. Even those proteins or the antigens, they differ in a single amino acid, can also be recognized. That is the specificity by the immune system. The second characteristic feature is diversity. The immune system is capable of generating a large number of antibody diversity in recognizing the antigenic molecules. The large number of antibodies will be generated after exposure to the antigens, that is called as a diversity. The third feature is a immunological memory. The immune system has an important feature, that is immunological memory. That means on the second encounter with the same antigen, that generates the immune response very fast and quick than the first primary response because of the presence of immunological memory. Self and non-self recognition. Self tolerance is an important feature of our immune system. Means it prevents the reacting to the self molecules, body's own proteins, and they do not cause any immune response. That is the ability of the immune system that they could recognize the self and non-self recognition. So important features are antigenic specificity. Antigenic specificity means they can distinguish the antigens that can differ in a single amino acid also. Diversity, a large number of antibodies will be produced in recognition with the antigenic molecules. That is a diversity. Memory means the secondary response is very faster than the primary response. And the self and non-self recognition ability is present in this acquired immunity. So these are the four features present in the acquired immunity. Now coming to the types of acquired immunity that can be gained by means of a natural means or by means of an artificial means. But it is again active and passive. It is two types, active immunity and passive immunity. Active immunity is the resistance developed by an individual as a result of exposing to the antigenic stimulus. It involves the active functioning of the immune system. It involves the active functioning of immune system. Active functioning leads to the mediation of HMI, means humoral mediated immunity, and CMI, cell mediated immunity. It sets only after a latent period. The latent period is observed in this immunity. That is the period required for the immunological cells to be set in active and functional. There is a negative phase during which the level of measurable immunity is less than the before the antigenic stimulus, because the antigen combines with the pre-existing antibody and lowers its level in the circulation. That leads to a negative phase, and the immunity that is developed here, it is long lasting. If the person is actively immunized and the immune response, it has an immunological memory, it will be throughout the life even. Or it is more effective than the passive immunity and gives better protection than the passive immunity. But it is not applicable for the immunodeficient persons. Immunodeficient means those who are having the suppressed immune system. For those persons, this active immunity is not applicable. But passive immunity is the resistance that is transmitted passively to a recipient in a ready-made form. But here there is no active role of immune system. There is no antigenic stimulus. Simply the preformed, already prepared antibodies are given to the recipient. There is no latent period. Latent period is the period taken by the immune system to be functional. Such latent period is not observed in the passive immunity. It is effective immediately after passive immunization. And in this passive immunity, no negative phase. Negative phase is also not observed. Immunity is transient, usually lasts only for days or weeks until the passively transferred antibodies are metabolized. And it is less effective. There is no secondary type of immune response because it is not having any kind of immunological memory. So it is less effective. Importance here is it provides an instant immunity and it is applicable for the immunodeficient persons. These are the differences between the active immunity and passive immunity. Next, moving on to the mediators of active immunity. The mediators of active immunity are here the humoral mediated immunity and the cell mediated immunity. In the active immunity, the immune system plays an active role. Active role means here they induce the immune response. Immune response in terms of humoral mediated immunity and cell mediated immunity. What is the meaning for humoral mediated immunity? Humoral mediated immunity is the immune response mediated by the antibodies, gives protection against the extracellular bacterial pathogens and the viruses that are infecting the respiratory or the intestinal tract. In this humoral mediated immunity, the B lymphocytes, they recognize the antigen and they are transformed into plasma cells. These plasma cells, they secrete the antibodies. These antibodies are mainly involved in inducing the immune response. That's what the humoral mediated immunity. Here, antibodies here, they also mediate the hypersensitive reactions. Hypersensitivity means this is an exaggerated immune response to an antigen shown by the host that is injurious to the health rather than giving the protection. That is what the hypersensitivity. Hypersensitivity, here it is again classified into two types. Immediate hypersensitivity and delayed type hypersensitivity. Immediate hypersensitivity is of three types. Type 1 hypersensitivity, type 2 hypersensitivity and type 3 hypersensitivity. These three types of hypersensitivities are induced by the antibodies. And this is generally the antibodies are also involved in the, it is thought to be involved in the early graft rejection. That means whenever the tissue is donated and it is transplanted onto a host, that leads to the rejection of the graft. So in the early graft rejection, these antibodies are involved. Once again, humoral mediated immunity is mediated by the antibodies. Generally, it gives protection against the extracellular pathogens, bacterial pathogens, viruses that are infecting the respiratory and intestinal tract. TH cells are also involved. And the antibodies here, they also mediate the immediate hypersensitivity, which again includes type 1, type 2 and type 3 hypersensitivities, and is thought to be involved in early graft rejection. The other immune response by the immune cells is a cell-mediated immunity. The cell-mediated immunity is mediated by T cells. T cells are again two types, TH cells and TC cells, T helper cells and T cytotoxic cells. So these T cells, they are involved in this cell-mediated immune response. T cells are activated. How they are activated means when the antigen is presented along with the major histocompatibility complex that is present on the surface of the antigen presenting cells, then the T cells get activated. That leads to the production of cytokines. These cytokines that are secreted by the activated T cells, they activate the various phagocytic cells, activate the phagocytosis process to kill the microorganisms. So the cell mediated immunity is offered by the T cells. The T cells are activated only when the antigenic peptide is expressed along with the MHC2 or MHC1 molecules present on the surface of the antigen presenting cells. Here the antigen presenting cells are those cells that can process the antigen, and they present the antigenic peptides along with the MHC2 on its surface for the recognition by the T cells. Then the T cells, they bind to the antigenic peptide along with the MHC molecules and they get activated. The activated T cells, they release the cytokines. These cytokines again, they activate the other cells and phagocytic cells, which enhances the process of phagocytosis and kill the microorganisms. So here the CD4 T cells and CD8 T cells are both are involved, and it also mediates the hypersensitivity reaction, that is delayed type of hypersensitivity. Majorly, it gives protection against the viruses and the fungi and the intracellular bacterial parasites. To these, this cell-mediated immunity gives protection, and it also involved in the graft rejection. That rejection either by means of homografts and the graft versus host reaction. When the grafts, when the tissues or the organs are transplanted to other person, then that leads to the rejection process. That's what is called as a graft rejection. In the graft rejection, the CMI has a major role. Both these HMI and CMI, they form the two kinds of immune responses which are considered as a adaptive specific immune responses. So next we will move on to the active immunity is again natural and artificial. Natural active immunity is by means of an infection to a microorganism. It is long lasting and the duration varies depends upon the type of pathogen. For example, immunity that is produced by for the chickenpox and the measles, that would be long lasting. In case of influenza or the common cold, the immunity appears to be short lived. It's a very short period because the influenza undergo antigenic variation. It can cause recurrence in an individual after few months also. This is about the natural active immunity. The second one is the artificial active immunity. This flowchart here is about the artificial active immunity. Means it is the resistance induced by the vaccines. Artificial active immunity. It is the resistance induced by the vaccines. So what are vaccines? Vaccines are the preparations of live or the killed microorganisms or their products used for immunization. Vaccines are the preparations of live or killed microorganisms or their products used for the immunization. Generally, different types of vaccines are used. They are first one is conventional vaccines. The second one is purified antigen vaccines, and the third one is bacterial products, toxoid vaccines, and the fourth one is recombinant vaccines. The conventional vaccines. The conventional vaccines, again, it contains live vaccines and inactivated vaccines. Inactivated vaccines are called as killed vaccines, and live vaccines are called as attenuated vaccines. The examples again here, the bacteria and virus. For the inactivated vaccines, bacteria and virus. Purified antigen vaccines, the example here it is pneumococcal polysaccharide. Let me explain one after the other. First we will see the conventional vaccines. Conventional means they are the old vaccines first developed by Jenner, Louis Pasteur using the microorganisms. Live vaccines are produced by means of a attenuation process. What is an attenuation means? Attenuation is the process that can be used growing the pathogenic culture or the pathogenic bacterium or the virus for prolonged periods under abnormal conditions. That abnormal conditions lead to the loss of virulence in those microorganisms that makes the organism to be weak. That weakened strain is now able to induce the immune response but do not cause the disease. That is called as attenuation. The live organisms are attenuated using the chemicals. One such example for this live attenuated vaccines is BCG, Bacillus Calmette-Guerin, that was developed by growing the organism, that is Mycobacterium bovis. Mycobacterium bovis, that organism was grown in the medium containing the increasing concentration of bile. After 13 years of growth, this strain now had adapted to the growth in high strong bile concentrations, and that strain became attenuated, and that is used as a vaccine for the tuberculosis. The advantages of live vaccines here. They provide the prolonged immune system. The exposure to the epitopes or the antigenic recognition sites of the attenuated organisms. Attenuation just weakens the microorganisms. The antigenic sites are not changed, so it is almost similar to that of the infection with the original pathogen, but it does not cause any infection. or disease. So there is an active role of immune system. Both CMI and HMI can be mediated, and it leads to the production of immunological memory. For this live vaccines, disadvantages or these are the live forms. They can mutate, they may mutate or revert back to the virulent forms. Virulent forms means they can be able to cause the disease. And the another one is they can be associated with the complications after the vaccination, similar to those seen in the natural disease. This is the disadvantage of the live vaccines. Live vaccines can be prepared by attenuating the organisms. The disadvantage is the reversion back to the original forms. The second conventional vaccine is inactivated vaccine or killed vaccine. The protection by these vaccines is only for a short period. It is less immunogenic than compared to live vaccines. The organisms are killed in these vaccines by means of heat and the chemicals. The organisms are incapable of replication but allows to induce the immune response. They cannot grow, they cannot replicate, but they are able to induce the immune response. The important feature during the preparation of this vaccine is the epitope structure should be maintained during the inactivation process. Chemical treatment is more effective than the heat process. Chemicals or formaldehyde or alkylating agents are used successful for the preparation of these killed vaccines. The disadvantage for this killed vaccine is they often require booster doses. Booster doses are those doses they are given repeatedly because the immunity is for short period. It's not so effective compared to live vaccines, but these killed vaccines induce humoral response predominantly than the CMI. That's why they are less effective than the live attenuated vaccines. But the advantages for these is they are very safe. There is no risk associated with them. There is no reversion back to the original form. So, and they are stable. They can be transported. These are the advantages of the inactive or killed vaccines. These two form the conventional vaccines, live vaccines and inactivated vaccines. Example for the bacterial live vaccines is BCG, Bacillus calmette-guerin and typhus vaccine. For viral vaccines, that is polio, yellow fever and MMR, measles, mumps and rubella. Measles, mumps and rubella. The second inactivated vaccines, examples, bacteria, they are cholera and plague vaccines, virus, injectable polio vaccine, rabies and hepatitis A viral vaccine. This is about the conventional vaccines. Next one is the purified antigen vaccines. Purified antigen vaccines means here the virulence for some of the organisms, they depend upon the structures external to the cell wall, that is a capsule. Capsule has an antiphagocytic properties that make the microorganism to be virulent and to cause the disease. So vaccines are prepared using that capsule, purified capsules. One such example here is Streptococcus pneumonia, which causes pneumonia that induce the opsonizing antibodies. Another example for such one is vaccine for Neisseria meningitis, which causes meningitis, also consists of a purified capsular polysaccharide. Purified antigen, the cell surface structures are purified and they are given in the form of vaccines. Pneumococcal polysaccharide is one preparation prepared from the capsule of Streptococcus pneumonia. Another one is meningitis, Neisseria meningitis. Next one is bacterial products, toxoids. here the not the microorganisms but the products that are released by the microorganisms are pathogenic and cause the injury to the host. Such products are called as the toxins. Toxins are again two types, exotoxins and endotoxins. Exotoxins can only be inactivated into toxoid. Exotoxins are the proteins that are released outside the bacterial cell. Such examples here is tetanus and diphtheria. So exotoxins are here inactivated by formaldehyde to form toxoids, and they are used in the form of vaccines. The more recent and advanced one is recombinant vaccines. The recombinant vaccines means using the RDNA technology. It's not the whole microorganism or the surface structures, but the genes that are coding those surface structures and giving the antigenic nature are cloned, and they can be used for the preparation of vaccines. There are different types again: subunit vaccines, DNA vaccines, and recombinant vector vaccines. Subunit vaccines, the genes, again the whole protein that is having the antigenic nature is cloned, and it is used for the preparation of vaccine, HPV, human papilloma virus vaccine. In the subunit vaccine polypeptide, it is not the whole antigen. Here the polypeptide that is responsible for the, which is having the antigenic nature, is cloned, and that is used for the production of vaccine. Example is one HPV. In this HPV, this is the first recombinant antigen approved for human use. This HPV vaccine was developed by cloning the gene of a surface antigen, that is HBsAg, hepatitis B surface antigen, that is produced in the yeast cells. The recombinant yeast cells are grown in the large fermenters, and they are harvested and purified. It's given in the form of vaccines. The other one is DNA vaccines. DNA vaccines here are more recent, and the trials are going on for the production of DNA vaccines. These DNA vaccines utilize the plasmid DNA that is coding for the antigenic proteins. They are directly injected into the muscle of the host cells of the recipient. When these DNA, plasmid DNA carrying the gene of antigenic proteins, when they are injected directly into the muscle of the host cells, the host cells, they take up the DNA and they produce the immunogenic protein that induce the immune response in the host. They are under trial. One such is a bird flu vaccine. Recombinant vector vaccines, it is under trial again. Here live attenuated organisms, either bacteria or viruses, which do not cause any disease, can be used in the form of a vectors, because they already lost the virulence. These attenuated organisms, now they replicate in the host like a vector, and they express the gene products of the pathogen. There is no reversion in this. Generally, many number of organisms are used for the vector as a vaccine. Examples are vaccinia virus, attenuated polio virus, adenovirus, attenuated strains of salmonella, retroviruses, and the BCG strain of Mycobacterium bovis is also used. All these microorganisms are used in the form of a vector in which the gene product of pathogen is inserted and used for the expression. These are under trials. This is about the vaccines which form the category under the artificial active immunity. Vaccines are the live or killed microorganisms or their products used for the immunization. Vaccines are different types, conventional vaccines, again live vaccines and inactivated vaccines. The major difference between live and inactivated vaccines are live vaccines are attenuated, that means the virulence is decreased. Here in the inactivated vaccines, the organisms are killed. Live vaccines, the disadvantage is reversion. Inactivated, the disadvantage is the many booster doses are required. Only predominant immune response is HMI. And the purified antigens, here the structures of the microorganisms which are having the virulent property are purified and they are used for the preparation of vaccines. One such example is Streptococcus pneumonia and the Neisseria meningitis, which cause meningitis. The third one is the bacterial products. They are the exotoxins. Toxins, they are the metabolic products produced by the microorganism. There are two types, exotoxins and endotoxins. Exotoxins are released outside the cell in the form of proteins, and whereas endotoxins are present inside the organisms, they could not be converted into toxoided. Exotoxins, they can be inactivated by using chemicals and can be converted into toxoided. Examples for such toxoid vaccines are tetanus and diphtheria. The more recent advanced one is recombinant vaccines. The recombinant vaccines are different types again. The subunit vaccines, DNA vaccines and recombinant vector vaccines, and subunit vaccines, the gene coding the whole protein and the gene coding the only polypeptide can be used for the preparation of vaccine. DNA vaccines, here the plasmid DNA is directly having the antigenic gene can be inserted directly into the muscle tissue of the host for the expression of this antigenic gene. There are many limitations for the DNA vaccines, but it's under trial. Recombinant vector vaccines, here the microorganisms which are attenuated, they are used in the form of vectors to carry the antigen that need to be expressed. This is also again under trial. So this is about the artificial active immunity. Next, passive immunity. Passive immunity is again either natural and artificial. Natural passive immunity. Natural passive immunity is the resistance transferred from mother to a baby. In the human infants, the antibodies from mother are transmitted through placenta and through colostrum, means milk. The colostrum is rich with IgA antibody. These IgA antibodies are resistant to the intestinal digestion and gives protection to the infant. The IgM antibody is produced at the 20th week of life of the child, infant, but at the age of 3 months, the infant acquires the some kind of immunological independence. Until then, passive transfer of maternal antibodies give protection to the infant from the infectious diseases. The active immunization of mothers during pregnancy also improve the quality of passive immunity in the infants. The second one is artificial passive immunity. This is the resistance transferred to a recipient in the form of ready-made form pre-synthesized antibodies. The antibodies here are the hyperimmune sera or convalescent sera or the human gamma globulin, pooled human gamma globulin. Hyperimmune sera or the convalescent sera or the pooled human gamma globulin, they are prepared and they are used in the artificial passive immunity. These are also used for prophylaxis and therapy. Equine hyperimmune sera, such as ATS, that is anti-tetanus serum, is prepared from the horses. which are immunized against this tetanus. The serum is collected, and from this the antibodies are separated, and that is used as an anti-tetanus serum. Convalescent sera is the serum of the patients that have recovered from the infectious diseases. Those who have recovered from the diseases, from those the sera is collected, and that is used for the administration of antibody. That is the convalescent sera that contains high levels of a specific antibody. Pooled human gamma globulin. This is the gamma globulin fraction obtained from the sera of the healthy persons. Contains the antibodies against the pathogens that are prevalent in that region. Passive immunity generally provides an instant immunity. This is about the passive artificial immunity. Combined immunity. Combined here, both and active and passive methods are used. Whenever the passive immunization is required for the immediate protection, then the combined immunization is preferred to the non-immune individual. So this is about the acquired immunity, active and passive immunity. Let me explain the differences between the innate immunity and adaptive immunity. Innate immunity is inborn and it is non-specific. It is not having any memory. The major components here involved are skin, mucosa, and antimicrobial proteins, substances, complements, acute phase proteins, antiviral interferons. The major cells are phagocytic cells and the natural killer cells. When it comes to the adaptive or the specific immunity, it is the immunity that is acquired either natural or artificial means. Both active and passive immunity, they come under this acquired immunity, adaptive immunity, and it is very specific, having the immunological memory. Majorly, the lymphocytes, T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes are the major cells involved in this adaptive immunity. The key points to remember here in this overall topic of immunity is what is immunity and what are the types of immunity and what are the mechanisms that give the protection in the innate immunity and acquired immunity. In the acquired immunity, types of acquired immunity, active and passive, artificial acquired immunity in the form of vaccines, and passive immunity, natural and artificial means. With this, I am concluding this topic, immunity. Thank you for watching this video.